I am Noveline Brewster, the Chief of Corporate Communications here at the Central Bank of Barbados, and I'm delighted to welcome you to this presentation on the global economy, a Kenyan perspective, by Governor of the Central Bank of Kenya, Dr. Patrick Njoroge. Please join me in extending a warm welcome to him. My leader, Mr. Haynes, has been hosting him since the beginning of this week, and they've been locked in talks on a number of issues of mutual interest. These talks are aimed at building and strengthening our bonds. Njoroge's visit to Barbados follows that of a visit by his leader, Mr. Uhuru Kenyatta, in August, and Mr. Kenyatta met with our leader, the Prime Minister, Mia Amor-Motley. So the governor's discussions, from what I understand, focused on direct investment, trade and cooperation, on efforts related to anti-money laundering, countering the financing of terrorism, air service agreements, tourism, renewable energy, and mobile financial services. Kenya is one of the world's biggest users of mobile money, and I told Mr. Njoroge when I met him on Monday that how he became very familiar with Kenya, the M-Pesa is used widely in Kenya. Over the weekend, I was listening to a podcast on the BBC where economists, researchers, and a former Greek finance minister were weighing in on a suggestion from Mark Carney, the governor of the Bank of England, that the world needs an international digital currency to restore and maintain the stability of the global financial systems in light of the threats of currency and trade wars. The speakers cited the M-Pesa as a secure and stable digital currency, in essence, as a model digital currency. To put today's conversation in context, however, I invite my leader, the governor of the Central Bank of Barbados, Mr. Clavison Haynes. Mr. Haynes.
Thank you, Noveline. Good morning, all. Like Noveline, I'm delighted to welcome you to this presentation on the global economy, a Kenyan perspective, with the governor of the Central Bank of Kenya, Dr. Patrick Njoroge. As Noveline indicated, the President of the Republic of Kenya, His Excellency, the Honorable Uhuru Kenyatta, visited Barbados from August 7th to 9th, 2019. And during that visit, he and our Prime Minister, the Honorable Mia Amor-Motley, pledged to strengthen bilateral ties and create stronger linkages between Kenya and Barbados. This visit by the governor and his delegation, so soon after the president's visit, is a sign of the commitment of our respective leaders to ensure that this pledge begins to bear fruit in the shortest time possible. Over the past 2 days, the governor has had the opportunity to meet with the private sector and public sector officials to discuss mutual areas of cooperation and collaboration. It has been an opportunity for our respective teams to share experiences on our respective approaches to economic challenges and to identify areas that we can explore for further collaboration. During our discussions, we recognize that governments can lay the framework, but it's our people that determine whether these efforts succeed. Despite our ancestral links with Africa, many of us do not often get the opportunity to interact up close with our brothers from Africa. And we thought that it would be remiss of us if we didn't take advantage of the governor's presence here this week to share perspectives on how global developments are impacting Kenya and Africa more generally. Despite the distance, the difference in size and resource endowments, you will find that our countries share common challenges, and I'm sure that you will hear this in the governor's presentation, not least the fact that we both have been in IMF programs of late. Now, Dr. Njoroge is the 9th governor of the Central Bank of Kenya, and has been in office since June 19, 2015. He has overseen a significant overhaul of the banking system in Kenya, including the launch of the first Kenya banking sector charter. He's also led the country in the launch of the new generation currency banknotes and coins, thus fulfilling a much anticipated constitutional requirement. He has been keen on facilitating the growth of the micro, small, and medium-sized enterprise sector, which has been the engine of growth of the Kenyan economy. He joined the central bank after a 20-year career at the International Monetary Fund in Washington. Prior to his appointment as governor, he was advisor to the IMF Deputy Managing Director from December 2012, where his responsibilities included assisting in overseeing the IMF's engagement with a large swath of IMF members. He also served as Deputy Division Chief in the IMF's Finance Department, the IMF's Mission Chief for the Commonwealth of Dominica, and in other capacities since 1995. Indeed, he is quite familiar with the region. Prior to joining the IMF, he worked as an economist at the Ministry of Finance and as a planning officer at the Ministry of Planning. He holds a PhD degree in economics from Yale University, a master's degree in economics, and a bachelor's of arts degree in economics from the University of Nairobi. His professional and research interests lie in macroeconomics, economic policy, international finance, development economics, econometrics, and monetary policy. He began his second four-year term in June 2019, and he has been appointed to the UN Task Force on Digital Financing by Secretary General Antonio Guterres in November 2018. During our discussions over these 2 days, I found him to be quite affable and generous with his knowledge, and I'm sure that you will find today's lecture both interesting and informative. Let us welcome Dr. Njoroge.
Thank you very much, Governor, Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. I'm delighted to be here before you today at the end of a few days of intense discussions with the representatives of Barbados, our newfound friend in the Caribbean. I'm sorry, I don't say Caribbean. I'm still a bit old-fashioned, so I say Caribbean. But at the outset, I want to thank the Prime Minister and for the invitation for us to visit Barbados, and also the very warm hospitality that we have been accorded since our arrival. By, in particular, the Central Bank of Barbados, and indeed everyone else that we've met over the last few days that we've been here. We are coming to the end of our trip, but we are going back not only rich in memories, but we are going back with even higher expectations of our engagement. And I think that's something that I'm sure the governor shares, and we will see how this, once we have reported to our respective principals, how this will serve to bring together the people of both countries and indeed the people of both regions, the Caribbean and indeed Africa. So that's what I would want to say in terms of what we've done, but I think all of us are following very closely the vision that was set out by the Prime Minister and also our President in their discussions a month ago. Today's discussion, I would want it to be less of the details of those the discussions that we had, obviously, and more about the global perspective. I know it was announced as the Kenyan perspective or the Kenyan, the global perspective from the Kenyan, I don't remember now what it is, global economy from the Kenyan perspective. You know, we could have actually switched these things around a little. But when I've spoken before, at times I try to capture my remarks around the topic, why Kenya? And and also what is happening in Kenya today. And maybe this, we could easily have changed it to why Kenya and Barbados? And I want to capture that from the perspective of what's going on around us, meaning the global perspective, the global economy. But we need to begin where, in a familiar territory, and I think I want to go back to Africa. At least for those of us that don't have some of the numbers, it's interesting when you see a picture of Africa like that. It's bad in that you generally don't see a picture or map of Africa next to another, like the United States or Asia or Europe. I mean, Africa compared to Europe is nothing, meaning Europe is tiny. Kenya, you can see where Kenya is, it's actually the size of Texas. So it is actually a big landmass. And Africa is three times the United States, three times. Somehow you don't quite get that from the various maps that we are used to. Three times. In terms of population, Africa has about 1.3 billion people, 1.3 billion, compared to, let's say, the US, you are talking, what, 300 million, something like that. So already you're beginning to see that Africa isn't what you have always, one would always think, which is sort of a place with maybe with famines, you know, or place of poverty and things like that. There are the numbers that I think we often don't quite see. For instance, of the top 10 fastest growing economies in the world, more than five of them are in Africa. So now we are talking economics, and you can already see that there's something else that's there. We'll talk about the potential in a minute, but I think it's interesting to note, just baseline numbers, that there is a lot in Africa that perhaps we are not familiar with. Now, when you talk about just size, you then talk about resources. And I think the colonialists at the beginning, they saw the size and instantly said, yeah, there are resources there, let's exploit the resources. And maybe for those of us that are into history and political science or political issues, historical as well, they can tell us maybe why is it that things were that way. But that is really not the business of our conversation today. But suffices to finish this, to explain, to make the point that there are resources in Africa, and maybe the issue here is to find a way of exploiting them for the benefit of the people, meaning the benefit of the people of the continent and those that they are linked to, such as the Caribbean people. And so to be sure that we're having a better South-South discussion, your Prime Minister is very strong on this South-South engagement. And I think it is a consequence of one of the reasons why I am here today, leading this mission that would actually initiate, I don't want to call it building a bridge, but initiate this intense relations with a nation that is halfway around the world, but that is very similar to us, very similar to us. That is Barbados. Now, I want to say a few things about Africa and where we are economically, but I think the way to put this is to make the point that for several years, it's true economic management in Africa was not just subpar, it was horrendous. And we know that economic outcomes in terms of growth, inflation, current account, debt, all those things were not positive, they were all negative. But then there came the 90s. I guess the worst decade was, or the worst years were in the 70s and 80s, but the 90s came by. And indeed, there was, and towards, let's say, the early noughts, And there was a sense of moderation elsewhere and a sense of substantial improvement in the economic outcomes in Africa. And for about 10 years, actually, Africa was going very strongly, on average. And I think there were several reasons for that. First, of course, is the commodity prices. There was a commodity price boom. So for those resource exporters, they benefited a lot from that. Now, the resource exporters, you are thinking people who are, let's say, oil exporters, think of metals, primary metals. Most prices were increasing. And now, after a while, actually after about 10 years, the tide turned, and there was sort of a gradual decline in the prices of primary commodity prices. And in a sense, this became the so-called super cycle, where prices came down and have remained depressed on average from where they were, say, 15, 20 years ago. But commodity prices was part of the reason why many of the economies in Africa actually were doing well. But that is not all. There was obviously the good policies. You could say that the quote-unquote Washington consensus became accepted, that you need to do the right thing in terms of, for instance, pursuing private sector friendly policies, not only private sector, but you could say even other market-based policies. So the things about subsidies to state enterprises, controls on exchange rates, or controls on capital controls and things that, there's a sort of a sense of liberalization and so forth. Now, there is also a third element here, which is the debt relief. If you remember, this is a time when we had the outcomes of the so-called HIPIC and MDRI debt relief that was that benefited something like 40 countries, around 40 countries, some of which actually got complete debt relief. Remember, this was the time after the 2000 Jubilee kind of thing, and there was a lot of pressure and political pressure in the world to provide those poor countries a sort of, some relief so that they can start correctly. This amounted to debt relief, reducing their debt with the understanding that those resources would be used to uplift the or social spending, such as schools, health, and things like that. So that was, everybody was happy. But like everything else, the story changes. What happened then? The story here is one of globalization, if there is one word I would want to mention now. It's really an issue of globalization. But what happened is there was the expansion, but the expansion also led to some specific, let's say, seeds that would lead to, or seeds of future problems. And one of these is there was excitement about now there was more space that had been created for borrowing. And a lot of us, a lot of countries, went out borrowing, issuing sovereign bonds. These are the euro bonds. And so there was this sort of wave of new borrowing. And the argument then was infrastructure. You do have a lot of infrastructure deficit. So why don't you borrow? You have room to borrow. So borrow to build roads and all these other things. Also, there was another argument that I really liked at the time, which is that by borrowing from the markets will enforce discipline on the authorities, meaning there'll be much more scrutiny of the budgets and their policies by the markets, right? And that way, there'll be some sort of stability and so forth. We know better today. But But at the time, it was actually, we all bought into this argument. Then there's also other things that were happening, and a name that comes up is China. So China also came into the act and was lending, some would say recklessly, others would say strategically. Depends which side of the political divide you are in, or that argument. And in a sense, there were concerns, which are there even today, that they were lending without concern about the sustainability of those nations. And in some sense, they were lending so that they could, let's say, end up having free access to all sorts of resources that were available in Africa. I don't know, that argument I think is a bit too blunt, and I think one can nuance it a little, but for the purpose of this discussion, I think it suffices. So you can already see there was a change in terms of the borrowing structure in Africa and so forth. The trouble is, like everything else, the limits of that progress is set by other problems that come came later as we drew closer to, say, 2010 and the global financial crisis in particular. But I want to underscore that there were benefits to globalization. And it's true, the arguments against globalization remain. It's true, we know that for every, and by the way, we are now rehashing those arguments again in the context of another issue, which is the China, America, or US trade wars. You know, so are there any benefits to globalization? The answer is yes. In terms of economics, yes, we do understand trade, and indeed globalization will allow us to specialize in particular processes where we are best suited, and that will benefit everybody. There will be Pareto improvement in the welfare of everybody. But what we don't know is how that welfare is distributed. Economists cannot make that argument. I mean, we don't know that. That's a political decision or a political outcome. Meaning, those sectors that end up getting shut down, and I think to bring it closer home, think about the banana industry in the Caribbean. Wiped out by some, maybe one could argue, as was argued then, it was never competitive because it was built on preferences and things like that. I'm being quite aggressive in this discussion, but I hope we understand each other. That's an argument we've had, I'm sure. The others that obviously put it differently. But I think the point I'm making is, think of the farmers in St. Vincent or Dominica. After that, there's no point in just telling them, look, you know, farmers in somewhere, I don't know where it is, you know, can grow bananas cheaply, much more cheaply than you. So, you know, just be nice and enjoy the weather kind of thing. That doesn't work. They have a livelihood. They're human beings. They need to have some productive means to occupy themselves, but also to generate income, which means there has to be those resources that are released from agriculture need to be moved to their other ways of engagement, and indeed their best, most effective ways of dealing with that. That is the problem that most of us face as economists, as politicians, and that is, it's not a problem of globalization, but it is really an issue that cannot be ignored. And I think that's really what happened. We did have some sectors in Africa that were closed, you know, just like the banana industry here and other things. But I think what I would mention, what I would want to underscore is the struggle then was with the implied adjustments, as I mentioned. And in as much as those were not concluded, you did have political pressures coming up. Now, I think we can see those political pressures in other, I think, the advanced economies. You think about all the pressures that are taking place or maybe 2 years ago are much more prevalent. All the political, parties, extreme political parties that were interested in, wanted particular outcomes from the politicians. Now I'm thinking, for instance, think of the people that elected the current president in the U.S. or the pressures, the Brexiters. I'm now not talking the new Brexiters. I'm talking of the Brexiters in 2016. You know, the arguments that they were making. So these are arguments of popular arguments. It's in a sense the rise of popularism in those countries, which we had already seen in our own countries, and we have had to deal with that in various ways. But there's now another item that came in. Another actor landed on the stage, while the main actor, globalization, was still on the stage. And the next actor, at least in Africa, was an actor by the name technology. Now, it's true in other countries, you think of technology in terms of benefiting the processes, the various production processes and things, and also maybe moving, telephone and all these things. But in Africa, and in particular in Kenya, the introduction of technology was definitely a systemic change in the whole process that we were having. So with technology, the world became smaller, that we know. The world is much smaller. You can call, for instance, somebody in California the same way you can call somebody in the other room. As a matter of fact, you don't even know where the person is, and it doesn't matter. The price of telephone conversations or telephone services have plummeted quite a bit. Now, I know there used to be that cable and wireless. I don't know if it is still around, but I'm sure it will be eaten up by, I am pretty, oh no, there may be some cable and wireless people in the room. So, but I do know that. I think we know the fights between cable and wireless and Digicel and maybe I'll come in and bring in my 5G service here, and Brazil company will do that, or some startup in Copenhagen or Kenya or Tanzania or whatever. I mean, the world now is much smaller. And even investments. I think one of the areas where the major changes have taken place in terms of investments, openness, is in the area of telecommunications, where you have, a South African company investing in Nigeria or investing in Jamaica, and vice versa. So there's a lot more openness. But I need to also say that one of the areas where you've seen a lot of corruption is precisely in this area of telecommunication. When the government, assigns the space or whatever. Yeah, the spectrum, So that at times is done in smoke-filled rooms in the middle of the night. And so there are issues there, but I think those are issues that we can handle, particularly if we know what is it that we are dealing with. So I hope the cable and wireless and Digicel people in the room are still comfortable, So the world has become smaller. And it's not just in terms of, I gave that example of telecommunications as an example, but there are other areas which I will, in the interest of time, I'll not cover. But for us in Africa, and I think elsewhere, but Africa in particular, fintech came on the scene, a bit like a minor actor who upstages the main actor or the prima donna in the place, and in the end becomes the dominant actor for some strange reason. I don't know whether that is a soap opera or some other Shakespearean story, but I don't think it fits with any of the Shakespeare stories I know, but I think we could discuss that after. But the point is that fintech, in Kenya it came via M-Pesa, as we were told a moment ago. And M-Pesa was one of these things that was brought to the central bank as a product, you could call it a widget, that really had potential, but needed to be improved to actually realize the potential. And this is something, by the way, I need to stress. Most of the things that come to us, and I think it's the same in any family, when the kids bring their ideas, what do you want to become, you know, or for that matter, when they bring the drawings they've done and projects and or even their report cards, they are still unfinished products. And I think the issue here is to look ahead and say, you know, this is an unfinished product towards something. And our job is to make sure that, you know, to clear the road so that the person can reach the final destination safely and quickly and so forth. So this product actually was improved in various ways so that it could actually deliver the transfers between people, you know, using the phone as the platform for that. Let's just say that this became a revolution. The first thing is the mobile phone revolution in Africa. Telephones, mobile phones are ubiquitous. I have photos of Maasai herdsmen in the middle of the savannah, and they always have a sword dangling like over here. They have two sticks, don't ask me why they have two sticks, and a spear. And then in all that, there's a phone. Two weeks ago, I went to one of the remote areas of our country, and this is part of the communications of governors, right? Going and talking to the population and all that. And by the way, I should say that one of the best communicators, communicators in central banks around the world is not other than the Bank of Jamaica. They've really pushed the idea of communication into the stratosphere, and anyway, we are all happy that that has happened, and we are learning, all of us are learning from them, and others as well. But anyway, so I was out in a remote area, and I met these traders, they are pastoralists, and they told me the most important bank, and the only bank they have, is M-Pesa. So governor, do whatever you want, but don't mess with M-Pesa. Basically, they go off for a month. You know, they're pastoralists. So if the grass is greener south, you know, a few hundred miles south, they'll go there with all their cattle, and eventually they'll come back when the rains come back. I mean, when the rains come and so forth. But during that time, all they need to do, in the past they were just not trading. And they didn't have any information or anything. But when all they do now is to go near a road, because the cell towers really follow roads, I mean the infrastructure, I think we understand that. And so they'll go near a road and they'll communicate, they'll get their money, they'll trade, they'll do whatever it is. They are connected to the financial sector. And more than that, they are connected to the rest of society, which is phenomenal. So there I was talking to these people, and it's a long story, but I think the point they made is that this is theirs. This is really what it's all about from their perspective. They don't need to go to any bank. I mean, what will he do? He has 100 camels out there. What is he going to do with the camels when he goes to the bank? So his point is, I'm okay where I am. Just make sure that that institution remains solid. So that's the benefit of it, I mean, an example of it. But the point I want to stress is that this has allowed us to do remarkable things, what I call the miracle of financial inclusion. This is not a big thing in the Caribbean because I think a lot of us, I mean, the financial inclusion numbers are much higher. I didn't get the numbers. I asked somebody to give me that, but I didn't get the financial inclusion numbers in the Caribbean. But they are up there, for sure. Much higher, actually, than the U.S., I'm sure. But I think for us, we went from 26% of our population was included back in 2007 to 83% last January. 83%. So from 26 to 83, that's remarkable. And the numbers are similar in Tanzania, in other places. So I think the issue here is the use of new technology appropriately for this new development and the benefit from that. By the way, in terms of penetration of cell phones, mobile technology, in Kenya, the numbers we have from January is 105%. So just think of that. So some of us have two cell phones. And I can tell you an example. You think it's somebody like me who has two cell phones. No. Actually, I only have one. It's bad enough having one. But my aunt has two. And you ask, why? She's about 90-something. But why does she have two cell phones? I asked her this. You know, so this is me talking to her, and so why do you have two cell phones? And she told me, well, eventually, it came out that she knows the differential rates, meaning of between the phones. And she uses one when the rate is lower. So talk about arbitrage. This is my aunt telling me something about arbitrage. And what I found interesting is she's not the one who's paying for the cell phones. It's my cousin who's paying for them. But somehow she still wants to make sure that, you know, the family somehow doesn't lose money because of... So she does the arbitrage business. But it's also interesting that the population are very, let's say, open to technology. I mean, I just mentioned that lady who has... my aunt, and I also talked about the pastoralist, you know, the guy with the camels and cattle out there, the Maasai. So people are very open to that, very open to new technologies and so forth. I don't think that is something that Steve Jobs really thought about, I mean, or had contemplated, or anybody else, but there it is. There are a couple of other things I wanted to mention in terms of technology. There has been significant improvements in infrastructure. I mentioned before the borrowing from Eurobond and things like that. But I think in Kenya, at least, there's been significant improvement in infrastructure, in particular, well, roads, but also electricity. So distributing electricity and bringing it down to the last mile, meaning connecting it to the houses and all those other things. So every school, for instance, is connected to electricity, or has an electricity connected to the grid. But there are also other solutions that have been put out there. But I think it is important to appreciate the benefit of electricity connection. It's not just they can now cook using, you know, less polluting form of energy and things like that. No, it's not so much that. It's also they can actually have TV, and it's not that they are watching soap operas and things like that. No. But it's amazing the way they feel that they've made it. I mean, their own self-worth because they have electricity, and other things like that. And in particular also, the kids can study in the evening. In the past, it was difficult for that because, you know, when the sun goes out, this is Africa, you know, 6:30, by 6:45, you cannot read anything. So you're done. But now they can extend their evening, which is important. Okay, I know I'm running a little late, but I'll accelerate a little. So I have talked a bit about Africa in general, the sort of drivers of things, globalization, fintech, at least in broad terms. But there's something else that I think I need to insist on. You know, one of the things that is amazing about Africa is about its youth. It is actually the numbers are just dramatic. I have something like, and I was going to confirm it, the numbers that didn't come. You talk about connection, but at times you still need human beings. Africa, Kenya in particular, more than 50% of its population is below 16. Just think of that. So you are talking of a nation of babies, right? And at that point, you can see, okay, maybe today there is a burden, right? All of us have our kids and we have to deal with them. But you can imagine when, in terms of economic terms, when you get that sort of demographic transition, and demographic transition kicks in, you're thinking of the number of workers that are supporting, say, the entire population. So you still have a huge, a huge set of the population that have yet to come into the labor force. And when that happens, and they are well used, the sky's the limit. Now, there's that point. They need to be well used. They may come in and get no jobs. What will happen? You'll have the equivalent of the Arab Spring. So you can see we are at a bifurcation. There is actually potential benefits or potential huge positive outcomes. But at the same time, this has to be after making the right decisions that actually use the people get employed usefully. The idea of having a bunch of young men and women listen, mind you, they listen, today they listen to the same thing that anyone else listens to. I mean, they have their cell phones, they have their messages, they are no different from youth in the US or the Caribbean or any of these things. They even dress the same way, you know, pants hanging and all those other things. It's a global problem, I think. But at the end of the day, it is our business as policymakers to make sure that there is actual work and useful work for them. So this is I find it odd when we talk, and the governor and I, when we go to Washington and places like that, and they have all these seminars about the future of work. And they talk about the number of people that need to, you know, the impact of, let's say, robots and AI on work and things like that. And my point is, wait a second. Tell me about the future of work of those African youth, and I'll tell you about the future of work of everyone else, because the future workers will be in Africa. As simple as that. I mean, whether we like it or not, the demographics are there. As a matter of fact, the populations in other places, Asia, for instance, China has already gone into its downspin, yeah, downward spiral, like Japan. Japan, of course, is an extreme, but we are all going there. So I think the point is that we need to appreciate that. Frankly, it is the realization that Africa is really that continent in terms of work in the future and also demand. We are still the continent that is growing quite strongly. So demand, consumer demand in the future. It is the realization of those two factors that now you have various companies wanting to move quickly to Africa. To do what? I had a conversation recently with some of the big fintechs that are coming through. Libra. By the way, if you are into fintech, you have to come to the Mecca of fintech, which is Kenya. It's actually not the Mecca of fintechs. I would use a different label. I think of it and as, well, we argue with the Ethiopians, right? For many, we have that competition, spirit of competition. And one of them is, where did the origin of man, okay? Where did, is it, obviously we all know it's Africa, but where exactly in Africa? They claim it's Ethiopia, we claim it's Kenya. And on those, on that ground, we don't discuss things, you know. We, so anyway, my point is, sure, they came and they were talking to us about Libra. Frankly, when you look at Libra, there's only one thing that makes sense to it. By the way, when they came, we brought them, we have a team. The team is the average age of the, no, the average age of the team is more or less like 30 years. So it's youth, sharp. Actually, you, Governor, you saw my team, and I think it was a pretty young team. I think that's where the future of Africa is, and indeed the future of the world in youth and all that. But anyway, talking to them, the only thing that made sense is they are here, they are coming in to begin getting our data. They are not interested in all the other things that they are talking about to make sure that money goes quickly. No, what they want is data. They want to know the spending patterns of these people, our youth. They want to spend, you understand, data is the new oil, as they say. So if they can jump, you know, sort of be there before anyone else, and I mean, they'll have monopoly rents that they can exploit. Think of cable and wireless on steroids, and you have exactly what this would be. I still hope that the cable and wireless people are here. So I think I wanted to make that point, that really the issue for us is the future. It's not just now. We can fix the problems we have now, the economic problems, the social problems. Sure, we know where we are coming from, and we have all those problems. We are not denying that. But I think it's the future. And this is why, well, as we'll come to close, I will make the point that the vision that actually has brought us here and the vision that the governor explained or mentioned in his remarks is really a vision for the future. It's not a solution for now. I mean, yeah, we'll resolve those things, but really, at the end of it, it is the future. It's about the future. Now, the world is not where we were 10 years ago. This part I'll go very quickly. I want to underscore that the world is much more fractured. Say 10 years ago, there was a lot more conversations in the various international fora. If you had problems, I mean, think about the debt issue. But then something went wrong. And all of you have your own views about what went wrong. In the past, cooperation was a watchword. No man is an island kind of thing. So HIPIC, for instance, was a cooperation by the advanced economies helping the, so there was a good North-South discussion there. Responses to catastrophes, right, all those things. And we also can talk about some of the catastrophes that have come through here. Maybe the last of this, I mean, think of maybe the drought in Ethiopia, you know, where everybody came around and we are the world kind of thing. And but then you end up to think of the what happened to Haiti, the earthquake. And maybe there was a lot of help at the beginning, but things have not fully been finished, right? Now we have Dorian. And I have to be truly honest to say that I was delighted when I arrived at the airport, when I arrived here. And they gave me a newspaper, you know, one of the newspapers there to look at. Well, somebody was getting my luggage. And in there was a They talked about a commitment from Barbados, I forget the amount, to the people of the Bahamas. And there were other commitments that were there, and over the weekend, I think there were various events, you know, racing, fundraising, and all that. The point is, we at least in the Caribbean have not forgotten the idea of cooperation. Others may have forgotten, but we remain with that. There are other issues in economic policies as well, which I think we've gone away from cooperation to being sort of king of the hill and the adores of, let's say, crabs in a barrel, you know, kind of mentality. I mean, think of the discussion between the US and China on trade, right? And we thought, as economists, the issue of trade wars, that was settled in the 60s. And here we are, this many 50 years later, still discussing things in this way. Now, just today, there's this sort of race to the bottom. And everybody's anxious, let's say, about the ECB, the Fed, Japan, about what their policies will be. Because everyone is trying to sort of race to the bottom, have a policy. Nobody is now cooperating. It's more we are on our own. And we have to have that policy that incorporates what the Fed will do, that incorporates what the ECB will do. And therefore, you come out. So I want to, the race to the bottom argument, in my view, or question, I think we've seen it here in the Caribbean. Think of taxes, the taxes to hotels, for instance, right? And you want, you know, they would come to one island and say, okay, we want to set up this hotel, give us certain concessions. Then you give them X. Then they'll go to this other island and say, hey, you know, give us some concessions. We think we can get away with X. Say, okay, we'll give you X plus 2. And then so you have all this, and then they'll go back and forth, right? That's a race to the bottom. In the end, they'll settle in the country where that actually gives them complete waivers for everything, and probably even pushes money into their pockets, you know, whatever it is. So the world is more fractured, but the world is even more volatile. Today and now, things are changing so rapidly. And just looking at the markets, they're moving dramatically. And you can say, well, it's the markets, it doesn't matter to us. Oh, no. It matters to us, right to the last person. Actually, the markets now matter to even that pastoralist I was talking about, because we are that connected. And because they are much more volatile, we as policymakers have less tools to deal with them. So you are warned. The world will only get worse. There isn't any stabilizing anchor. There used to be stabilizing anchors like a solid, I would even say mature, sort of economic policies from, let's say, the G1. G1 is the US, the G7, and other places, but not anymore. Now we are not sure what policy it is. And I think for me, I'm kind of interested because we are interested in this, because I need to know how to react, and I need to know how to deal with the pastoralists that I'm talking about and all the other businessmen and women that come to Kenya. So now the bottom line, what's the solution? The solution is simply, there are two elements of the solution. First is to strengthen regionalism. So because the world is so crazy, the first thing we need to do is to look at our neighbors, and we need to work with our neighbors. Now, that is a policy that I think was espoused by some of the people that were the politicians that, let's say, led the anti-colonial movement years ago. And you can say it's a very Caribbean sort of, let's say, position. It's amazing that when you've gone all around, you always come back to some particular standards. And this is one of them, the need for regional cooperation. It's true we talk about, in Kenya, we talk about Harambee. Others talk about Ubuntu and all these other things. And even here we talk about similar things. But I think the point I'm making is what underlies it is this thing of appreciating that we can do more when we are together. And cooperation is and building those connections. So Kenya, in particular, is a natural hub for that regionalism. And that's what we are trying to exploit. And indeed, when we have been speaking in the last couple of days, this is what we've put on the table, so that Barbados can actually benefit. And I don't know, I don't like the term, I'm sorry to you, I'm not diplomatic, I'm sorry. So by now you all know I'm not. But I think the point is, it's not Barbados as such. I mean, Barbados or even Kenya, I mean, it's not a country. It is the people of that country. It is really the people of Barbados and the people of the Caribbean and the people of Kenya and the people of Africa that will benefit from it. That's really the objective. And so we have this hub because we are highly diversified. We are connected to the rest of Africa. For instance, 25% of our, about a quarter of our exports go to the East African community. We have a community like you have CARICOM. For us, we intend to get to political unification, but that obviously in due time. And so to the other members, 25% of our exports. 40%, more like half of our exports, Kenyan exports, actually go to the rest of sub-Saharan Africa, meaning we are not connected to the old colonial masters or those directions. Those have kind of waned. And we've built these sort of connections with the rest of Africa. And that's really one of the things that we hope in this sort of bilateral relations that we started will benefit not just Barbados, but the rest of the people in the Caribbean. That is important. Then, of course, we have other things. I will not go through all of them, but I think it's important to say that we have also created the second largest free trade area in the world. The largest free trade area is called the WTO, or for want of a better. Now, whether it's dead or not, that's another issue. Who killed it? We'll need to read that book. But for now, we know that that is the largest free trade agreement. The second largest is the so-called Continental Free Trade Area, meaning Africa, Africa Continental Free Trade Area. We have the initial signatories were 44 member countries, and now they've increased because we have two other large countries that were holding out, South Africa and Nigeria. They all wanted more cookies. Anyway, in typical fashion, they eventually came in. And now you can benefit from that. I mean, because it's now Africa. It's really now Africa, not just Kenya or East African community around it. That is important to mention. Now, from our perspective, we're also looking at Barbados. Barbados being connected to the rest of the CARICOM historically, you know, just like ourselves in Africa, but also connection to the, I want to call it the hinterland. And the hinterland here is not quite the ocean, is all that swath of the Americas. And from our perspective, it's very difficult to get to Brazil. But through Barbados, it's a natural. Through the Caribbean, we can go to other places, particularly, and mind you, it isn't just using Barbados, it is for the Barbadian people to actually benefit from those transactions and so forth. Finally, one could argue that, I said there are two solutions. One is strengthening regionalism. The other one is having strategic bilateral relations. And your prime minister has been doing that, as we know. And also, our president has been doing that. And I would say that the two countries that, at least from my perspective, being Remember, I'm just a tool boy, right? I'm not the policymaker about strategic relations. I'm only the governor of the central bank. But I think in terms of the vision, we have the way it has come to us is, yes, the strategic vision, exploiting the various poles. And here we have Barbados. And we have another pole, which is Singapore. So between Singapore, Kenya, and Barbados, you have nice connection in terms of strategic relations and so forth. And so in a sense, it's true, we could have done China. But remember, China, as I mentioned before, has its own concerns, at least from our perspective. And in any event, everybody is going in that direction, and we want to be a lot more diversified. At the beginning, you need to be a bit strategic, and that's the strategic mind that I'm talking about. So, no one is an island to himself, I already mentioned, but I want to finish with a story that I told the governor and the others, and this is the so-called coconut story. Coconuts are grown everywhere here, and it's interesting. I personally don't like coconut juice. It's an acquired taste. Ah, okay, so we'll see. But I'm not into that stuff too much. But still, I'm into the coconut story. I once spent some time at a meeting with a regional meeting with the minister of a neighboring country, and the neighboring country was Uganda. He was an older gentleman, and needed walking around, you know, sort of with his walking stick. And we kind of struck off, you know, we kind of liked each other, and we hung out together. I'd help him. And so at one point he told me this story. I don't know how we got to this, but he told me. He had traveled somewhere, and he saw this farmer. Now there were coconuts, but he saw this farmer who was planting coconuts. So wait a second. Now coconuts take a long time. I mean, they are not like mangoes, or they actually take much longer than nutmeg. You know, nutmeg I think takes what, 7 years or something. So these things take a long time to actually grow and have fruit and all that. And this was an older man who was planting them. So he, my friend, talked to him, so he told me. So he began talking to him and said, "Hey, you're planting coconuts. For sure you'll never eat from these coconuts, will you?" And the farmer responded, he said, "Yeah, I am planting these coconuts, and I know I'll never eat from them. I'll never eat their fruit. And I eat fruit from this coconut tree that I myself never planted." So the minister turned to me and to tell me the lesson. And he said, "Our nations are at their best, when we plant coconuts that we know we will not eat from." That was the lesson. And the way we are today, the conversation that we have been having, this bilateralism, bringing our nations together, bringing our continents together, we are planting coconuts, all of us in this room, that we ourselves know will not get the full benefit from. Thank you for your attention. Oh, you want me to sit down? Okay.
Questions.
Oh, from here. Okay, very good.
Okay, thank you very much, Governor, for that very candid conversation. I love coconut water.
Oh, you do?
And I'm sorry you didn't tell me. I would have gotten you a juicy, a fruity, to enhance the taste of coconut water, and I'm sure you would have gone back with a different story.
But I like mangoes.
Okay.
But I like mangoes.
All right.
Yeah.
We'll find a close mango tree.
Yeah,
oh, sure. The governor's residence has a mango
yeah,
tree.
Yeah, so we'll go there.
We'll get some from
yeah.
him. Well, this is question time. We invite your questions. I see Hallam's hand is up, so we'll start with Hallam. Make sure to take the mic, be succinct, because we are on satellite time, not cable and wireless. So be succinct, Hallam.
Oh, goodness, we're on cable
thank
and
you,
wireless.
Thank you, Your Excellency, for a very stimulating and amazingly interesting presentation. And we've, those of us who followed M-Pesa know it's been a tremendous benefit to Kenyans in terms of households and that sort of thing. Kenya is also looking at developing its own blockchain technologies. In fact, I believe you're paying very close attention from what I see you on YouTube doing in terms of the Kenyan Blockchain Task Force. And I'm not sure whether it's a cryptocurrency, true cryptocurrency you're developing, or a digital currency. But my question relates to education, Your Excellency. It has to do with the fact that when we talk to students in Barbados, I find, and they talk about, we talk to them about smart contracts and blockchain technologies and that sort of thing, about the jobs and the benefits and the opportunities and how they need to prepare for it. It's kind of difficult because it's a very complex technology that you're talking to, although you know it's going to benefit them tremendously. Could you give us your thoughts then on how you think Kenya is going to brace this issue of educating this young generation you have to understand and to take on the technologies of blockchain and cryptocurrency and smart contracts and that sort of thing?
Okay. May I answer them?
Sure.
Okay. Okay, so I think my view is simple. The youth, all they need is some space and some sort of encouragement. So it's a bit like going swimming, right? Let's just say, I don't know how to swim, right? If I'm standing there and your job is not to tell me, you know, all the theory of swimming. Your job is really more to encourage me to jump into the pool and, you know, you're not gonna drown. I'm here and give me that, you give me the comfort that everything will be okay. Now, that's the general point, but in particular, we had, just to give you an example, we had the first Afro-Asian FinTech Festival in Nairobi in July of this year. And we had well over 2,000 participants in that event. And we had people from all over, Singapore in particular. There goes the bilateral thing I was telling you, strategic relationship. And there are many things that happened there, but we had two things I would point out. We had exhibitors, these innovators, something like 50, more than 50, more like 60 innovators, all of them youth. And the governor of the Monetary Authority of Singapore and myself had them for breakfast, meaning we invited them and we discussed their issues with us. And you know, in that team, I can assure you that in a year, you'll have significant solutions of things that we don't know. Because we've given them that space. And now they have, one of the things they're doing is they are coordinating among themselves. I mean, they have WhatsApp groups and other things that you and I don't know how to communicate, but they know. But just because we gave them that space. We also did a hackathon with them. And we got, I think it was something like 20-something entrants into this hackathon, or at least the ones that were selected to participate in the hackathon. And two of them, the winners, as it were, they'll be going to Singapore for the FinTech Festival there. Now, the winners, actually the one that won, the leader of that team was more like, I think her age was 25, right? And they are a team of five of them, and they had a solution to a particular thing, and they were off they go to Singapore. And we have others, 10 others, that we are going to help mentor in particular ways. My point is, the youth can actually develop those solutions if given the space, but you need to give them the right thing. One of the most important things that anybody, not just the youth, but all of us need to know, is that the way to go forward is first, understand what solution, what problem you're trying to solve. Quite often, they have brilliant solutions for nothing, right? And that is not just the youth, it's all of us, right? So you have you ask them, what problem are you resolving? So, no, don't worry about the problem. Look at this widget, look at the screen, look at this, you know. So guiding the youth in that way, I think, will go very far. Blockchain is just one. We are not into quote-unquote technology, meaning we don't select the technologies. Today it's blockchain. Tomorrow it will be something else. They are the innovators. They are the ones that should understand the technology and then figure out whether that actually resolves the problem that they are looking at. So I think what happens is we get bewitched by the names. And I'll give you a good example of that. When I was in Singapore last November, the Prime Minister of India said, I mean, this was his way of making a point. He was telling the innovators, if you need money to fund your project, what you need to do is to just say you're in fintech. And then people will come. You're in fintech, sure. But now, if you want them to increase their funding to your project by, let's say, 20%, just tell them you're in fintech and you're building a platform. Yeah? Yes. So if you're doing platform, then it doesn't matter. They don't know what platform is, but they're going to put. But if you really want them to open all their purse strings and throw money at you, just tell them you're in fintech and you're doing blockchain. Hope I've answered your question.
Yeah. Good example too of collaboration and cooperation. Mm-hmm. A question from me before we go back to the audience.
Yeah.
How did the Central Bank of Kenya build its appetite for fintech?
I don't know. I think it would be nice to say we thought through it and logic and no. I think happenstance is important. But I think from our perspective, we do have people who understand these things. Meaning they're interested in it, and we employed them for other reasons, but they ended up pointing the way for us. But I think the most important point for us was the realization at the beginning that it would be the solution for financial inclusion. That, I think, was everything else followed. Today and now, I have made the point that fintech is our best hope today on improving financial inclusion, particularly for those nations that are much further. Remember, there are about almost 2 billion, 1.8 billion in the world, people in the world that are still excluded from financial services. 1.8. So fintech can help us in terms of improving financial inclusion and also having reducing inequality, mm-hmm. meaning being more equitable in terms of economic opportunities. Mm-hmm. Fintech provides some of that solution. It's not the only solution. It's not the solution to everything. But I think from our perspective, this is the hope that we have. And we've been pushing this. And as you know, I was appointed as one of the members of the United Nations, the Secretary General, I don't know how this works, United Nations Secretary General's Task Force on Financial Inclusion and SDGs. It's a long name. Bottom line is, it's all about fintech, using fintech to deliver solutions in financial inclusion and also shared prosperity. So, and that is, I think, significant. The other potential solutions, but I think this is one that is within our grasp.
Thank you. We have another.
By the way, it's my full-time job is obviously being governor of the central bank, but I do have a night job, and my night job is to be a cheerleader for fintech.
Oh, nice. Yeah, sounds good.
Good afternoon, Governor.
Yeah.
Jumbo.
Si Jumbo. Excellent.
Yes. First of all, my name is David Bino. I'm the National Coordinator with the Global Environment Facility Small Grants Program, implemented by United Nations Development Program. And my question relates to debt, prosperity, and what you just said, financial inclusion. I want to commend you on an excellent presentation. And I love Kenya and many other neighboring countries. Every time I go there, I touch the ground, and I feel like I'm going back home. But you said that information is the new currency. And the information is stating that after the debt forgiveness in 2000 for many of the African countries, that debt is increasing rapidly for most African countries. And in fact, that debt is changing. The debt is changing because more of the debt is within the private debt, as you said, the Eurobonds and such things, private debt, and 15% of that debt is Chinese debt. And so you're also increasing or reducing the level of sovereignty because of the structures of this debt. In addition to that, because the debt is not owned, it's not African debt. I'm going to that question. It's not African debt. So the financial inclusion of Africans is not there fully, as it should be. Now, if you look at Norway and the UK, when they both found oil, they did different things. Norway sought financial inclusion from having a sovereign wealth fund, and therefore they're perpetually a growing wealth, while UK did other things, and they would have declined as a result of some decisions made. So as you view indebtedness, what are some solutions that you propose in terms of addressing this rapidly growing debt within Africa? I mind you, Kenya is not one of the countries that's growing as rapid as the others, but what are some of your recommendations? And what about inclusion, financial inclusion of the average citizen through private equity options so that they can be empowered as you invest in your own development? Thank you, and God bless.
Thank you, David.
Very briefly, I'll answer you by way of an example. What we are trying to do, pushing financial inclusion, is I'll put it different. I would say that we are trying to have a democratization of financial services. So forget just the financial inclusion. Financial inclusion and access to financial services, those are the rails. Those are the rails. Now we need to put on some wagons, you understand? And that involves what we call democratization of financial services. An example that relates to what you just said is we want to democratize savings, right? Domestic savings. Okay, so how are we doing this? Here's the example. We now can have a product. It's called M Akiba. By the way, most of the things that are out there are M something, right? And I will change my name to make it Njoroge, you know, the writer. But I'll have some legal issues, but let's first deal with the... So it's called M Akiba. And through this product, anybody in the country can buy government securities. Now, these are T-bills or bonds for as little as $30. $30. Now, $30 is what? For you and me, well, let me not give a good what $30 is to you. Mm-hmm. But who would need... Now, for you and me, if I want to buy T-bills or securities, I'll go to somebody like you. I'll go to the bank financial services sort of people, and they'll give me forms and this and the other. And, you know, so I'll buy, I don't know, 100,000 US dollars because I've saved that much and whatever it is, right? But 30 US dollars, who would want to buy that? Well, somebody who earns $5 a day. Mm-hmm. Who earns $5 a day? $5 a day is what? Maybe the guy that has the bus earns more than that. So this is like a watchman, you know, somebody who is at the bottom of the, you understand, at the bottom of the economic pyramid, or even the maid in a house, you know, probably earns around that, probably a bit more. So if they can save $1 a day, $1 a day, at the end of the month, they'll have $30 that they can actually invest in government securities. And just think about what that will do. Suddenly, you have a new savings option that demographic never had before. And this can be put in investments in road infrastructure, whatever else it is. But I think it's more important to understand that you have actually changed the culture of savings. That's what we are doing. And that's the democratization of financial services. Now you can, again, by the way, I didn't tell you, that is all on your phone. You're doing it on your phone, not on, you're not going to anybody with $30, you understand? Mm-hmm. And you're doing it all there, And that is what is remarkable about the tools that we now have. And that's why I said you have the rails, and all you need to do, using a bit of ingenuity, is to add on all these other services. I hope I've answered your question.
You have a question over here.
Good afternoon, Governor.
Good afternoon.
Given the growth of fintech in Kenya, how serious is money laundering, and what is your bank doing with it, doing to combat it? And secondly, how independent is the Central Bank of Kenya, and what are you doing to guard its independence? And what can you guide us in that regard?
Okay, thank you. Wow, two questions. Okay, let me begin with the money laundering one. Money laundering is a big evil, we all know that, illicit flows. And illicit flows generally go to places where they have, there's least resistance. That's water always flows downhill, gravity. So the point here is you need to build enough resistance filters. And so this obviously can be a source or a channel of money laundering, right? Cleaning your money in all sorts of ways. And so before, I didn't give you all the details about how you actually run the engine, as it were. I just gave you the high level thing, but we are talking obviously with the Central Bank of Barbados and others so that they can actually see, they can look under the hood and actually see how the machine works. And one of the elements there is having a good anti-money laundering and CFT sort of edifice. So for instance, before you get into this service, you need to do a typical KYC, know your customer sort of filters. And those are there. So they need to know about my services. And so the point is that it doesn't stand alone in the financial sector. It has to be connected, and you cannot introduce a weak point in the financial sector, a weak point in terms of AML CFT in the financial sector, because you may end up bringing down the entire financial sector. So let that suffice in terms of we do have those filters. And yes, when you do a transaction, it's also checked. But nowadays, it's actually very easy to do that with technology. Mm-hmm. Again, using technology, we are using, just to throw jargon at you, we are using soup tech and reg tech. I cannot tell which is which, but it sounds good when I throw it out there. So one is supervisory technology, and the other one is regulatory technology. But I think on AML CFT, there's a lot of work that has been done already in terms of having proper filters. And commercial banks do that as well. I mean, nowadays they don't have, it's true, you need to check the person that's coming in over the counter, but actually the transactions, think of RTGS, think of all the other, in the olden days it used to be TT. Now you have many more channels and they're instantaneous. And you have to check before you allow that to go through. So from my perspective, it appears instantaneous, but from the bank's perspective, they've gone through various filters. By the way, just to give you an example, when you run your Visa card transaction, like now I checked out at the hotel and paid by Visa or whatever it was, that transaction goes back to Visa headquarters or their check, I don't know what they call it, but they have a place in Virginia, there's another one in Singapore, and there's another, or somewhere in Singapore, and there's another one in Europe. That transaction will need to go back there, be checked, go through the various anti-money laundering checks and all that, figure out that I have money, my limit and all those other things, and then come back, and then the trader, the merchant, it says, okay, approved. Mm-hmm. All within 2.3 seconds. Mm-hmm. 2.3. So technology is there, and that's really what we're doing. Your second question.
Independence.
Okay, I think that's a leading question more than anything else. the independence part suffices to say that this is something that is being challenged in every single central bank that I know. And the best example here is the US Fed. We didn't, When I was in school and learning these things, and even later, the idea that the US Fed would be under pressure from the political class, I don't think that would enter our head. Today and now, just this morning, there was a tweet. I don't know from who. They are fake news. There's a lot of fake news in this world. You know, you have to warn you about that. But that tweet actually was very clear. It actually insulted the Fed in particular ways. I mean, they were called naive. Well, the word was naivety, although the word they were trying to get was naive. But English is not always a fast language. But let's just leave it, yeah? So that is important. But I think we as central bankers know that we are not living or working in a vacuum. So that is really where it is. Now, probably you're asking the independence because I'm here, you know, and it is my president who asked me to come. Remember, what I'm doing now has nothing to do with, well, has a lot to do with the central bank, but the point is that clearly we have to work to support the overall, let's say, objectives of the nation. There's no doubt about that. We have to be there. But we cannot, so we need to know what our limits are in terms of what our mandate is. And in our mandate, of course, we insist on independence. Mm-hmm. And that has been that lesson has been taught and learned over the last 20 years, the improvement in independence. But I think the point is we cannot just take that for granted. And that's one of the things we have to do in order to maintain our independence is to go back to the people and communicate about what we are doing. And I made that point about finding different ways of communicating. And for instance, I'm delighted
Amen.
To be... Oh, yeah. Okay, you buy lunch today. How is that?
No problem.
So for instance, here we are, and this is a way of communicating. And the Central Bank of Barbados is making this happen, and using what you may call its convening power, you know, to bring us in a room and actually having us communicate on these issues. So I think we need to appreciate the importance of accountability, communication, but independence, we let go our independence at our own peril. So.
Ms. Workman?
Hi, good. Oops. Drop the technology. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Ms. Watson.
I enjoy the presentation, and something in your presentation really struck a chord in my head. And that was when you were trying to make an example of Barbados, it's for Barbados, and so you said, no, it's for the people. And that's the context of my question. Within all, in fact, it's only when the gentleman here explained to me that it's financial technology. Can I say fintech? Fintech? Mm. You know?
Did he explain reg tech, super tech?
So for the people, so within all of these good perspectives about going forward and for the future, what's the present thing in terms for the people right now? And in any country, the things that I look at, be it Barbados, USA, Canada, Norway, America, you know, is access to healthcare, access to education, good transportation. And those are the three pillars that I always measure society by. I don't care what the fancy language is going on. If those three things are faulty, you know, what's the sense of the fancy technology? So could you just speak to those three pillars for me, please?
I'll probably speak to another pillar that you didn't mention, which is opportunities.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Opportunities. We as economists often think of, I did throw a big word there, which is sort of equitable, you know, equity in terms of income and all that. But most important, and we have discovered this, there are papers that have been written over, say, the last 10 years about this. The most important element in all this is equity in terms of opportunities. So if I'm from, let's say, a poor neighborhood, and there's this other person from a more you know, affluent neighborhood. What bothers me is not where I am, meaning I'm in a, you know, my neighborhood, and these things I have today are not as many as maybe my neighbor. But what is important for me and for everybody is the opportunities that I get. Mm-hmm. Opportunities in terms of education, there goes your thing. Opportunities in terms of jobs, right? And other things like that, healthcare, you mentioned that. So it is those things that, in my view, are much more, if you are thinking of what really drives us and what we should be looking at, is this sort of equity in terms of opportunities. So our society needs to deliver on those opportunities to all of us appropriately. Now, I would say that, now going back to the solution of, or the statement by Prime Minister Modi, if I were like some people, I'd probably say, well, but you know what, fintech will solve that. and I think I'll be lying if I say that. There's a lot that needs to be done in the old-fashioned way. You know, the traditional ways of figuring out, you know, for instance, how are the schools distributed? Are they given technologies that will even out things? You know, some schools, there may be schools in terms of a name of a school, but they don't have teachers, or they don't have equipment, they don't have computers. Well, another one has equipment and teachers that are teaching them coding and all those other things. And I think also a key element there is the gender gap, mm-hmm. you know? So girls are not going to STEM studies. They are going to, I mean, they are women after all, right? So why don't they just concentrate on cooking, on, you know, you understand the point. So I think that those are the things that we, who are now sort of have the steering wheel, you included, we in this room, need to push our societies to ensure those equities are dealt with. By the way, we can talk, I'll give you an example that shows you that given opportunities, people can do phenomenal things. Again, this is like the coconut story. It's meant to remain with you, right? We have this fintech platform where you borrow microloans. So very small loans, and really the people who are trading there are sort of like the ladies that are selling the street, the fruit seller on the street, that coconut water person, right? So they borrow in the morning, or they borrow, and then they repay, right? And this is their working capital. So we were looking at the data in this thing. And we discovered that most of the loans, a lot of the loans are being disbursed around 3 o'clock, between 3 and 5 o'clock in the morning, not in the evening. 3 and 5 o'clock. So we thought at the beginning that this was a problem in the system, meaning instead of AM, it has PM and PM. You know, the techies can do sort of crazy things. So no. It's actually 3 to 5 a.m. And we discovered that about half of them were ladies, which is also another puzzle. I mean, men, you could probably understand, right? Because, you know, I'm pushing this, but, you know, you'd sort of say, well, men are coming from the entertainment, you know, that they...
they're coming home.
They're coming home, right? So they're sorting their accounts, right? But definitely not women, you know? So it became even more puzzling, right? I know I'm going somewhere. We discovered that actually no. What happens is you have people that the agricultural market for products, you know, fruits and things like that, actually it works from about midnight to 6 o'clock. That's when it's really at its peak, because that's when the vegetables have been brought in, and that's when they are trading. So this is the wholesale market, not the retail market. So here's the story. These ladies wake up in the morning, they actually buy vegetables that they're gonna trade in the course. They're still at home. by phone, they call somebody, their contact, give me a sack of potatoes or whatever else it is, and they pay by phone. They will then ask somebody else, a young man with a cart, to go pick up the sack of potatoes and deliver them at the specific location, their stall. Then they wake their kids, they will prepare them, send them to school. Then she'll use one of those motorbikes, bike taxi to get to where she's going. And at 6:30, she's ready to go. I haven't even got to my office as the governor of the central bank. I'm lucky to have had my breakfast by then. But she has done all this. But then the puzzle. We discovered that this is a 30-day loan. But guess what? At the end of the day, she repays. The next day, she borrows and then repays at the end of the day. Clearly, this woman has no clue about financial operations, because if it is 30 days, just keep it for 30 days. What's the big deal? And after looking at it a bit, our people discovered, no, we are the ones that did not understand it. She understands the algorithm that is running this platform. So she understands that if she did that, if she did that 12 times, she would double her credit limit. So within 12 days, she can double her credit limit instead of 12 months, which is a year. I think it's clear who actually understands financial system. So she had the opportunity, she used it. And we were not there to tell her you should use it in this way. So I just wanted to stress the issue of opportunities, but I think the rest apply. Thank you.
Excellent example. We have two more questions, Mr. Nasser and then Dalton, and that's it.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon, sir.
I'm blessed to be here to hear you speak today. A lot of things you say I have a lot of interest in, but the question I want to ask you, sir, do you believe money is a motivator for the development of people? And if that is so, is it not, it would be my opinion that you would also have to agree that we are not using, people who look like us are not using the money wisely. And I would also go further to say that if money is truly a motivator for our development, then family life development obviously is not a motivator. And I believe, sir, that family development should be more important than money development, but in truth, to move the family forward, you need to have money. And when I look around and discover that people who look like us, I'm looking here today, one white person here, they don't need to come here, they understand money linked with family development is the key to success. We think having money and storing it in a bank is the key to success. Hence, we do not work towards the future development of our race. We work towards money and leaving it in a bank instead of investing and mobilizing so that our generation for the next 500-600 years would have wealth. And the reason why I say this, sir, is because I am convinced that the reason why no white people is inherited on one card is that they understand that you must use money for the development of your future. You cannot die, black people. You will pass on, but your race can't die. You must prepare for your race. I would like to ask you again, sir, do you believe money is a motivator for black people?
Thank you. I think I'll answer you with the story I gave you, the coconut story. As I said, as society, that gentleman told me that society is at its best when we do things that benefit others, not ourselves. My joy, according to him, will be to know that others will benefit after me. And it's my job to make sure that most people benefit. I'll never get paid for that, and I'm talking about this room. We'll never get paid for the things that we actually start. We'll never. In terms of money and things like that. Money is just a small motivator. As a matter of fact, at the end of the day, the most important motivator is not money. It will never be money. I mean, you can bribe people. But at the end of the day, What is most important is this. That's true. Now, you can talk about family and all that. That's all heart. That is it makes people do crazy things. Crazy things for the good and also crazy things for the bad. Just the heart. And I think that's our job. And unfortunately, what has happened is we have gotten bewitched, if you want to think of it that way, because of this money and all that. Money is a means to something so as to deliver something that I want. This is why in the question that I answered about opportunities, I talked about opportunities, that nothing to do with the value of those opportunities. It's me who will put the value in it. So I don't think we are misaligned. I only think that maybe I used coconuts. And you could ask me maybe what's the value of the coconuts. But I think at the end of the day, we have to appreciate that many of the things, we are in this world for a purpose. And we do many of those things not because we'll get the return today. You know, that's very utilitarian approach to business and all that. No. I mean, society is much bigger than that. Why do we watch cricket, for crying out loud? It's fun, we enjoy it. And something that makes us better, right? This is the whole business with sports, for instance. I mean, the business of sports is not NBA, who is getting the most money and things like that. It's actually that we enjoy it, right? We become better people. We become, that's where our heart is. So I think, sir, we are completely aligned.
Yes, sir. I'm very happy that you're here because we're accustomed to people with a different accent speaking to us. Ah. All of us are aware of our relationship between ourselves and Europe and sugarcane. We are aware of that relationship. We also, as a youngster growing up, we've been taught and by our former leaders about if we can become just like Singapore, how good we can get. So I'm very interested to find out about this relationship between Singapore, Kenya, and Barbados. Your president being here, and we saw our prime minister and your president planted a tree. Now we heard from you that you met with Singapore governor, you met with our governor. But how does the average person on the ground get this information so that at the end of the day, we benefit, as you said, all of us in this together, and for we to move forward as a nation? Because I see Ambassador Kamashaw is here. We know our relationship with CARICOM over the years. We've been trying, we went from Karifta to CARICOM, and we keep going on. How does the average person on the ground gets this information and shares the same vision that our leaders at this point have started to share? Because I'm sure a lot of people, some people will read something in the paper, some people might not hear about it, but this relationship has started. I think it's important that our people quickly get where our leaders are taking us so we can get on board.
I think that's a very good observation. Frankly, when as part of our reporting to our principals, the governor and I will probably raise that, meaning maybe there should be an occasion where things are explained a little more widely. So your point is very well taken. And at the end of the day, it is the two countries or the not just the two. In this case, we have Barbados and Kenya, but you can see you have a three-way thing there, right, with Singapore. The strategic partners, as the strategic partners come together, it's really the people that will need to benefit, and the other ones that will really need to carry the whole project forward. So for instance, one of the things we talked about was about the private sector. Now, we can talk as much as we want about the private sector in Barbados, working closely with the private sector in Kenya, and it could be put in a communique, and the prime minister and president could sign a document that we have agreed and so forth, that has been read by lawyers and with appropriate ribbons and wax and all those other things. But at the end of the day, the private sector doesn't move. It's a dead document. So it goes back to that issue that you mentioned, that they actually need to understand and be part of it. They are the ones that will actually put not just the energy, but make it work. You know, so the channel has been opened, but who's actually going to use that channel? It's actually ourselves. So I think it goes back to the issue of why is it that they are doing it. It is really for the people. And so we've just charted a sort of a skeleton image of what can happen. And that needs to be fleshed out, in particular using all the actors, and the, in my example, the private sector. And there is a lot. I mean, the issue isn't that what will limit us is our own ingenuity and our own views about, you know, how much we can put ourselves out. That, I think, is what will limit us. But beyond that, I mean, but I think that's still way, way, way ahead of us.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
I thoroughly enjoyed your conversation.
Yeah.
And two final takeaways for me, as Simon Sinek, the leadership guru, would say. We have to understand our purpose, and as my Latin teacher will tell me in school, carpe diem once you got the purpose. So thanks again. That has seized the opportunity.
Okay.
Yes. So,
when we get the coconut water, you talk
I'll
about...
I'll give you the juicy and some
very good.
Mangoes
thank
from
you.
The governor's residence.
Okay, that's
so
a
thanks.
Thank you very much.
Yes, you missed it. Okay, I now invite my colleague to move the vote of thanks, Sherry Bishop. Sherry.
Hi, good afternoon. Ladies and gentlemen, I think we can all agree that this has been quite an interesting and engaging session. So let me begin by thanking Governor Njoroge for his presentation this morning. Governor, your insights into the Kenyan economy and the global economy will be useful not only to those in the economics profession, but to all of us who have an interest in global affairs. Let us take this opportunity as well, certainly on behalf of the Central Bank, to thank you and your entire delegation for the rich and productive discussions we've had over the past few days. Governor Haynes, thank you for hosting today's seminar and for your opening remarks this morning. You aptly and succinctly encompass the importance of events such as this. To my colleagues in corporate communications, services, maintenance, and the Frank Cullum Hall, as well as to Mrs. Roseanne King and Mr. Matthew Williams Rawlings, thank you for organizing this seminar. Your hard work is very much appreciated. And finally, to you, our audience, both in person and online, thank you for joining us for today's seminar. Your interest was evident and your questions were thought-provoking. Now, we encourage you to share this presentation, which is currently available on our website and our Facebook page, widely with your colleagues and friends. So once again, thank you very much and have a good afternoon.